Greetings, my name is Max Russell and I am the social researcher for the project From East to West, The History of Ugandan Asians. We are honoured to share with you this special panel discussion entitled The Ugandan Asian Expulsion of 1972, The Silent Voices in Between. Before we begin, I would like to introduce you to our panellists and to our moderator. Firstly, we have Senator Mobina Jaffer. Senator Mobina Jaffer represents the province of British Columbia in the Senate of Canada. Appointed to the Senate on June 13, 2001, she's the first Muslim senator, the first African-born senator, and the first senator of South Asian descent. Secondly, we have M. Iqbal Asaria CBE. Iqbal Asaria is a visiting professor at the London Institute of Banking and Finance, visiting faculty at the Bangor Business School, visiting faculty at the City University Bayes Business School, and director of the AFCAR Group of Companies. And thirdly, we have Dr. Amir Gulamhusein. Dr. Amir Gulamhusein, a career anatomist, he graduated in 1969 from Makerere University College in Kampala, Uganda. He has subsequently held senior academic positions at the University of Leicester Medical School and has also worked at the Aga Khan University Medical College as the professor of anatomy. And to moderate our session today, we have Dr. Mohamed Keshavjee. Dr. Mohamed Keshavjee, a lawyer and a respected commentator on the African Indian diaspora who won the prestigious 2016 Gandhi King Ikeda Peace Award. Now, before we begin, I would like to pass you over to the project's creator, Fiyaz Mughal, OBE. Fiyaz Mughal's working history includes over 18 years' experience in the community and voluntary sectors in positions that have included social policy lobbying, project and general management, conflict resolution work, and working with leading organizations as the chief operating officer. He was also the director of Faith Matters from 2005 to 2020, which he founded. Faith Matters is a trusted not-for-profit organization that for over 12 years has worked to tackle extremism and to build resilience within various faith and other communities in the UK, Europe, and the Middle East. I now pass you over to Fiyaz Mughal.
Thank you very much, Max. And it's a real pleasure to have a panoply of individuals around the table, as they say, today. It's a real opportunity to have the experience of individuals who were directly in Uganda in 1972, who had a history of being in Uganda, whether that's through familial links, whether arriving there for work. But what they have in common is they have a connection to 72, to a past and a history in Uganda, and sadly to the expulsion in 1972. So we're very honored to have individuals with that experience, but also in a way reflective of the kind of experiences that they will talk about today. And when I say reflective of the kind of experiences that individuals will talk about today, the From East to West project is really about understanding the impact of the expulsion from Uganda, not just the impact about coming and settling in the UK. That is one narrative that's been promoted and passed. And it's a very strong narrative around success in the UK, but that's not the only story. In fact, today we will hear experiences around trying to settle it in a different cultural, a different physical, and a different societal environment. We will hear about the issue around trauma and how trauma has been carried, possibly through generations, but the reality of trauma being carried through the settlement process. We will hear clearly about mental health impacts. And we will also hear about the issue around identity, possibly race, and belonging, all issues that actually affected individuals from Uganda and also affect individuals when they migrate to another location and another place. Now, Ugandan expulsion was not migration. It was the ejection and it was the tearing out of individuals who had roots in Uganda, who had a place in Uganda, who had a space in Uganda. So it was a violent process. It wasn't just about saying, well, leave. People were injured, people were harmed, people were killed, and people left behind their lives and left behind their memories. But today is also about understanding where people have got to in the journey of the last 50 years. And I want to leave you with two thoughts. In my personal journey, now at the age of 51, I only realized over the last year the impact of the Ugandan expulsion that happened to me personally. I was 2 years old and at 51 realized that actually what I've carried since the age of two has been a form of trauma, a form of PTSD that I've carried for many years, not realizing what it was, a sense of dislocation, a sense of not fitting in, and a sense of actually feeling that somewhere else was home. And I guess through reflection and realization, I have realized that actually even at a young age, Amin's expulsion affected me in many different ways, some good, some bad. And that's the legacy of the expulsion from Uganda. Some good things, but some bad things. It's not about saying that everything is hunky-dory and everything was rosy. So we want to capture this for posterity. We want to capture the experiences for future generations to learn. But we also want to make sure people get the breadth of experiences, the breadth of understanding of how people's lives were affected, and the breadth of knowledge about the way that individuals had to adapt, change, deal with, cope with, and manage the enormous process of expulsion that took place in 1972. Thank you, Max. I'm going to pass over to you, but it's a real pleasure and honor to have this panoply of individuals with a huge amount of experience and understanding around the table today.
Thank you, Fiyaz, for giving us an excellent background. And as Max and you both have mentioned, we are very fortunate to have with us today three outstanding individuals who were at the cutting edge of destiny at the time, if I may call it, who had to change their own careers because of the position they held in each of their families and be able to help their families chart out a new destiny for themselves in countries they were not even sure of. In our discussion today, we have agreed among ourselves that we will refer to each other by our first names. That will help us to make this discussion much more personal, much more human, and much more humane. But for the sake of protocol, I will start first addressing each of our panelists by their position, and thereafter I'll call them by their first name. So for our first question, I will pose it to Senator Mobina Jaffer. Senator Jaffer, you have had an absolutely fascinating life, filled with all the vicissitudes one can think of that any individual has to go through. I would like you to reflect, where were you on the 4th of August, 1972, that fateful day when Idi Amin passed his edict that all Asians should leave the country? Senator, I want you to reflect on where were you on that day, with particular reference to what was the position of the Asians in East Africa 2 or 3 years before that diktat, and how do you place it into context, having seen the last 50 years? Can I throw the ball to you and let us know what you feel?
Thank you very much, Mr. Keshavjee. I appreciate being on this very amazing panel. But before I start, I want to say my career had a lot to do with you, Mr. Keshavjee. I still remember how you took me to Gray's Inn. And I think that was a ladder that helped me a lot. So I want to thank you publicly. And I want to start with saying that on this August 4th, 1972, of course, none of us forget, my husband and I were attending his older brother's wedding in Jinja, that's near the falls. And when we heard that Idi Amin, President Amin, had made this announcement, I honestly have to tell you, we laughed. We didn't take it seriously. I know it's hard to believe now, but we didn't take it seriously. We thought, oh, it's another dream of his, and tomorrow he will change his mind. And we proceeded with the wedding and celebrations. And then next day, when we were going from Jinja to Fort Poto, another small town in Uganda on the western side, we saw so many cars leaving. Cars with Asian people in it leaving to go to Nairobi. That's when it stuck to us that this is quite serious. And, you know, you asked me what was happening in the last few years before we were expelled. And I want to say to you that my mother was a social worker and a probation officer, and she would go many, many times to prison. In fact, once or twice a week. And she'd always come back very sad and say to my dad, and we'd hear her saying to my dad that, you know, many political prisoners in the prisons are being hammered to death because they are saving the bullets for another day. And that was our sign that things were changing. And also the whole atmosphere was changing. There was no longer a parliament. My father was a member of parliament. Parliament had been dissolved. There was no more parliament. But we didn't get it. We didn't think it would involve us because we were Ugandans. And we sat in this belief that nothing can happen to us because my father was born there. I was born in Uganda. And it was our home. My father had fought for independence of Uganda. He had been a member of parliament for a long time. From that, how can we possibly be thrown out? We were maybe naive, but you know, when you're in the situation, you never know. You never know what's coming. And nobody can forecast that we would be thrown out like this overnight. And even when Idi Amin made the announcement, we didn't take him seriously because we thought that he will change his mind. And we thought that he wouldn't be able to be, we were in that way, I would say arrogant. We didn't think that he would be able to function without Indians. But it was very, very sad when we were thrown out. It was a terrible experience for us.
Thank you, Senator Jaffer. We'll now move to Professor Iqbal Asaria. Professor Asaria, you, I believe, were not in Uganda at that time, but certainly you were very much there in spirit and in soul. Can you tell us about your family and your circumstances and what was your first impression when you heard this fateful diktat that made it incumbent that everybody had to uproot?
So thank you, Mohammed. I was here. I just finished my master's and my father had come with my sister and brothers because they were about the age of going to university. So I just come to settle there here. But as a family, my father and his five brothers and everybody else had taken up Ugandan citizenship. So we were very, very determined that we will be staying in Uganda. There's no other way. So we would be studying and then going back to do whatever was possible.
I take it by year, you mean United Kingdom, am I right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So now the problem was that when we heard this, you know, in those days were not days of internet and phone and everything. So even to get in touch was quite a job. We had to dial through the operator and go and just find out what was happening. And as Senator Mobina says, we initially thought that it's all kind of hot air on the part of Amin and it will go away. But when things became more complicated, and then obviously the Ugandan Asians, those who had Ugandan passports became stateless. And so the problem was very, very complicated. And we started to hear from my uncles there that they had to queue different embassies to see who would accommodate them, who will give them a visa. So some people ended up in America, some people got here who were British, and then the rest had to go to Pakistan because Pakistan was still open. It was not an easy place to stay, but that was the only option open. And I think since that day, I, as the eldest son and my cousin, who was also elder, son of his father, we spent the good part of 10 years getting family back together from Pakistan, passports in order, nationalities in order. I could take you blindfolded to the home office because I had made so many visits there to regularize things. But there was one good thing that none of us was injured in any way or harmed in any way. The bad thing was that our business was distribution of textiles. So in the distribution chain, as you will know, we take one lot and we collect money for the last lot. So when this happened, there was no more going. So all the collections in the chain was gone. So effectively 80% of our wealth was destroyed on that, month. But what we also did was that we had a little bit of cash because we were quite a decent business. We helped quite a number of people to buy, at that time you could buy a round the world ticket. So we helped them to buy a round the world ticket so then they could figure out wherever they wanted to go. So those who couldn't afford, we helped them to do that. And that is one of the redeeming features. I think we did well, not only look after our family, but even after our community, people who were not able to do that, and they were managed to get to wherever, to Europe, Pakistan, America, wherever with that ticket. And those days you could change it to go wherever you wanted to go. So I think it was, well, as Senator Mobina says, it wasn't traumatic because it wasn't really sinking in that this is happening. But over a number of years, obviously, it sank in. We became, from a wealthy family, quite hand-to-mouth family here. And two of us who were just finishing our degrees had to look after 27 members of our family in the UK.
Thank you, Iqbal. Let's go to Dr. Professor Amir Gulamhusein. Amir, I think your experience is slightly different, but can you tell us where were you on the 4th of August, 1972, and what happened forward?
Well, I was in London at that time, pursuing my postgraduate degree at the London University. And suddenly, you know, we heard that all the Asians were being expelled from Uganda. It was a time of extreme concern emotionally. And it was very difficult to realize how this was going to impact the situation of my family, having lived in Kampala for so many decades, since the arrival of my grandfather in the 1890s and the birth of my parents in early 1990s. And all my siblings, 11 of us, my father was born in India, my mother was born in Uganda, and all the siblings were born in Uganda, and they were all Ugandan citizens. So I had just returned from Uganda back to London the year before, having married there in 1971, having seen what the prospects were, you know, for postgraduates, you know, contribution to the Ugandan government at the university. And all that fell apart, you know, with this announcement. And I could not go back. And going back 2 years prior to the expulsion, it was quite clear at that time that there were rumors and there was a lot of discussion taking place amongst the local populations that the Asians were controlling the economy of the country without involving the local inhabitants, not integrating with the Africans and living a prosperous life, exporting revenues overseas in spite of acquiring citizenship. It appeared to me that the writing was on the wall for them when President Amin, when he begged to become president of Uganda, usurping Milton Obote, and he wanted the Asians to comply with the wishes of the local African inhabitants. And it was a very difficult time. I was on my own. All my family were in Uganda, except my wife, who had recently joined me after our marriage in London. And we were in a desperate situation, me being a student, you know, which I had obtained a fellowship from the Ugandan government to support me to pursue my postgraduate studies. And it was really traumatic time. I was worried as to what will happen to my situation as well, having now the Ugandan government had taken, you know, charge with a new president. I was extremely worried that being a student in London, how am I going to support and look after my family who would be arriving in England? My family was split because many of my eldest sisters had already got married and they were stateless and they went to Canada. My brother was going to Europe to a refugee camp, and only my parents and my two younger sisters were to accompany my parents back to England. And we were then worried as to as and when they arrive, what would be, what we would be able to do for them, to accommodate them, look after them, and see how they were actually settled in a country which they had never visited, neither they knew the language, and they were not familiar with the people that they are going to come into contact. So for me, at that time, being away at that time, it was still a worrying and emotional turmoil that I had to face. Thank you, Mohamed.
Thank you, Amir. You know, you three are very interesting for one particular perspective that you bring to this narrative. You know, we've been hearing a lot of stories about teenagers coming with their parents, remembering what happened on the way to Entebbe. We hear about how people arrived in the camps and how they managed to, get used to a new life. What I find interesting in each one of your lives is you were in a certain hierarchy in your own families. And no doubt your parents had to turn to you and tell you that, look, our destiny is changing. There may have been anecdotes, little examples. Maybe we could start with you, Iqbal. Do you recall those 90 days unfolding? What was the next step once this dawned on you that Idi Amin is serious about this? Do you recollect any conversations with your father, your mother, with the elders of your family, calling upon you to change your direction in order to cater for a larger extended family? Iqbal, could you relate to us some of those moments, if you can go back in time? Because we want to capture that dimension of the sacrifice made by some of you. So Iqbal, start with you.
Thank you, Mohamed. So I think what we don't realize now, and we did then, that August onwards, autumn and winter sets in, yeah? And those people who had come from there, they had no idea of shorter days, colder climate, snows, and all kinds of things. So it was quite traumatic for them to adjust to this climate. But anyway, what happened is that once it sunk in that this is real, obviously people's other members of the family started to come, and we started to work on the paperwork and things, as I've mentioned. But my father, he said to us, to me and my cousin, obviously, he said, look, whatever it is, I do not want any one of you to be on benefit at all. And anybody who wants to study, we have to support them to study from the family. And he said, if you have to sweep the floor, you sweep the floor. We managed to hire a house from a Ugandan, actually, in Harrow. So that's why we are still in Harrow. We only person who would rent it to us, because there was no guarantee or anything. And we started working. And my cousins, brothers, who were still to go to university, they started going to university. One thing I remember clearly is that the universities then said, we have to charge you overseas fees because we haven't been in this country for 3 years. They said, we are refugees. How are we going to pay this? It was £250 that time, but quite a lot of money in those days for the fees. Anyway, we managed. And today, with the grace of God, everyone in our family is a graduate. So my father's wish was delivered one way or another. For me, I had an offer from my professor to do a doctorate. I had just finished my master's. And then we discussed with my father. He said, you know what the situation is, yeah? This is no time for doctorates and things. My professor was saying, I will give you the money to do this, please. I said, no, I don't want to. I can't do it. I have to look after the family. So we started. We bought a small shop in the East End. So we had to go from Harrow to East End every day, opening at 6 and closing at 7 in the evening, 7 days a week. So I found a job. Luckily, with the Prudential Insurance Company as an investment analyst. In fact, when I went for the job interview, it was very interesting. There was an economist called Mr. Minto. And he said to me, "Where are you from?" And I said, "Look, I'm a refugee from Uganda." He said, "Oh, I'm a refugee from Malta. You start tomorrow. There's no need to interview you. Start." So that was a lucky break, because Prudential was one of the more prestigious places to work for at that time. And so I used to go to the shop at 6, go to work at 8, come back to the shop at 6 again, and go back home at 10. And Saturdays and Sundays, go to the shop. So there was no time to fall ill or think of anything else, but just put your head down and work. And I think 5 to 10 years of that really put our family back in its shape.
Thank you, Iqbal. Let's go to Mobina. Mobina, you, I think, were one of 4 girls in your family, or 3 daughters. And your father was a very prominent person in the Ugandan political firmament, right up from, if I can recall correctly, in the 1960s, early 60s. I think that your father did a lot for African education, was a very prominent person in nation building. Mobina, what do you recall of your father telling you in those few days? Here you are, a qualified barrister from Gray's Inn, newly qualified in the country, full of hope, and suddenly the reality comes into place. Do you recall certain moments, certain anecdotes, certain examples of how those days unfolded for you, Mobina?
So you know that I said to you that we did not take Idi Amin seriously, but obviously there were signs all around us that the things were going to change. And one sign was that in June of 1972, Idi Amin's soldiers came after my dad. But my dad had sent one soldier to for education. And so he warned my dad. And my dad was able to get out of the country. But it was very difficult. But he was lucky. He had prepared. My sister had a surgery. So my mom was in England. And 3 sisters were in England. And what he did was able to, you had to have Idi Amin's permission before a politician could get out of Uganda. And luckily for my family, and my dad, Idi Amin was not in town. And so my dad went to the next in command and convinced him that he was only going for my sister's surgery. He got on the plane, but we started getting calls that my dad had been killed. And all night we were just, you can't imagine what we went through. And my mom was with us as well. And she was the only one who told us, just pray. He will come. Dad will find a way. Next morning, my dad knocked on the door. This was in June. Next morning, my dad knocked on the door and he was safe. Cannot imagine how that must have felt. We were just over the moon. We've never forgotten that day. We've never forgotten what happened, because we got so many calls giving us condolences for the loss of my dad. And some kind people were giving us details of how my dad was taken, how he was, I'm not going to go into details, but how he was treated, what happened to him, what happened to his limbs, all kinds of details, which we didn't need at that time. But thank God, my dad arrived at the door. Now you will think that this happened in June, then why would I and my husband go back to Uganda? Well, you know, when you're living in a situation, you don't think it's going to happen to us. My dad was a politician, so we could justify that he was in a bad situation because he was a politician. I wasn't, my husband wasn't, so we did go back. We went back in end of July 72 to get my sisters out of the country, because 2 of my sisters were left behind, and also attend the wedding of my husband's brother. Now that sounds so what do you say? How can you even think of that? But that was our reality, you know? And as soon as my dad got into UK, he contacted the politicians he knew and started to try and get help for people who were left behind, including his own family. It wasn't an easy time, but when I look back, it was like, we were in a haze. You know, we were just thinking one day we will all be able to go back. So it wasn't like a permanent move. We were in a haze, and then came my husband's family. So we were literally 13 people living in a London small house, a three-bedroom house, but we thought it was temporary. But as we all know, this was not temporary. And then Canada opened its doors. And in the end, we all settled in Canada. But the one thing that I have to share with you all is that it took me a very long time. My dad said I wasn't forgiving, but it took me a very long time to get over, especially what happened to my dad, because he was a person who integrated. He was a politician. So even our challenges, our work in Uganda was not accepted.
Thank you, Mobina. Amir, your example again is interesting. You were one of two brothers, and I think about nine sisters or so. So can you relate to us your experiences, Amir, of those days following the declaration by Idi Amin?
Thank you, Mohamed. Just before the time of the expulsion, you know, both my parents had British passports, and all my siblings were born in Uganda. And we were quite happy and settled very well. And my father was the sole breadwinner in the family. And he supported all of us in all matters, in education, in lifestyle situations, through provision of... he had three businesses and five houses. So from his income, you know, he supported all of us. His generosity to his family and other relations were remarkable. And I was wondering how he managed to support us all, nine siblings and mother and uncles and so forth. And one of the things about himself was that in his business, he was a trustworthy employer, and he offered credit to all the Africans when they came to shop at his business without any security at all. And for that, you know, he was very well known. And I recall him going to the income tax office in Kampala, and he informed the person there that my son has been awarded a fellowship from the Ugandan government. And they said, this is because of your generosity. It is now for Uganda to pay back to your family, to your son. And if you go back after that, having known that what was going to happen to the family, I was the oldest male, fifth in line. And I had to begin to think about responsibilities of looking after my family and all matters after the arrival in the UK in time to come. And my utmost anxiety was about being able to manage this heavy responsibility, being a student living in London with limited funds from the Ugandan government fellowship. These funds were only adequate to support my life in London, staying at a subsidized student accommodation with limited resources for daily expenses. The intention was of me and my wife, who had joined me in March 1972 after completion of her medical degree from Makerere University, was to return to Uganda and offer our services to the local citizens. As a result of that, of expulsion, my wife started working as a doctor in London. And together we decided to support my family in every way we could when they arrived in England as Ugandan refugees. The first step in England after being expelled from the country, from their home, ever since their birth, was a refugee camp in the middle of the country. When we went to meet with them in their camp, they appeared to be confused and totally devastated, having lost everything they had possessed, worked for throughout their lives. It was hard to understand their emotions at that time, especially they had landed in a country which was completely unknown in its language, lifestyles, and its people. And since I was not allowed to find accommodation for my parents and two younger sisters at my student residence, I had to find the rented accommodation for all six of us. And this was very difficult to acquire to find suitable accommodation in London at that time with limited funds. After arriving from the refugee camps, my parents were able to qualify for the benefits from the local borough councils as refugees. One very important matter I want to highlight here, that in spite of the changes in the government in Uganda, after the expulsion of the Asians, the Ugandan government did not stop my fellowship fund until the completion of my postgraduate PhD studies. This generosity by the Ugandan government was truly appreciated, and it was my intention to return to Uganda as a mark of loyalty to my alma mater. All throughout my undergraduate studies at Makerere University from October 1966 to July 1969, the Ugandan government provided all my expenses, which included tuition fees, accommodation, as well endowed student halls, all the meals throughout the academic years, a handsome book allowance for acquisition of course textbooks, laboratory equipment, and also pocket money. For me, this was an important appreciation and a profound gratitude to the Ugandan government that I owe without reservation. I was truly fortunate to be awarded a Ugandan fellowship from the Makerere University as an Asian, in spite of the process of Africanization of all government institutions that the Ugandan government had recommended to be pursued at that time. Thank you.
Thank you, Amir. That's very heartening. It's another dimension in the narrative that we don't normally hear. But I'm going to now swing back to you, Senator Mobina. Mobina, I was looking at in YouTube that you'd done earlier, and it was again fascinating how our lives have been parallel, that when I arrived in Canada, I had to go back to law school. And I was a criminal barrister in Kenya. In 1 year, I believe that the newspapers publicized my cases so prominently. And the next year, I was at a university in Canada, literally selling hot dogs on a Saturday morning to earn money for books and tuition. You know, Mobina, your journey has not been easy. Canada has been absolutely fascinating, but there were also bottlenecks. There is what I would call institutional prejudice in a way that you could not. I mean, I was told that with the English barrister at law qualification, I could not qualify. And I wanted to know that William Osgood was a British barrister. I mean, the very name of the Law Society of Upper Canada was after a person who was trained at the Inns of Court. And I wanted to ask them, did he have an LLB? But at that time, beggars couldn't be choosers. So I ended up selling hot dogs. But eventually, I qualified as a lawyer at Queen's University. So Mobina, can you tell me about your journey, the highlights, the difficult parts, and what has given you inspiration to be where you are today, a great champion of women's rights? You've done some work in Sudan, in Darfur. You've done a lot of work in international fora to make the world a better place. So Mobina, what did you go through?
So I want to say to Amirali that my husband also had a scholarship, and his scholarship also continued. So that's the beauty of Uganda. And, you know, before I answer your question, Mohammed, I want to say to you that, you know, it is the thing of going back, even if my dad was almost killed, is the love of our country. We loved Uganda. And so when I came to Canada after finishing my law degree and my qualifications, my bar qualifications, I expected that my journey would be easy because it's common law. it's law that comes from England. It's common law. Students from England, Canadian universities used to come to Queen Mary College, London University. So I didn't expect what I got. 3-4 days after I arrived in Vancouver, Canada, it was a shock of my life. I went to the Law Society thinking it was just pro forma to get the forms, to get my accreditation done. And literally the door was slammed on me saying, no, there is no, we will not give you the forms. Can you imagine? They won't even give me the forms. I went 15 times because if there's anything, I am persistent. I didn't succeed. So then desperately, I looked for a job and I went through the direct dictionary and I went through all lawyers trying to get a job in a law firm. And I saw a Dohm, D-O-H-M, and I phoned him and he used to be a Supreme Court justice. He had just finished. He was intrigued that I would call him. So he gave me an interview and I ended up becoming a Girl Friday. And he, after a few weeks, he came to me and said, I'm puzzled. You were a lawyer in England and now you are working as a Girl Fridays to do all the Joe jobs, all the difficult, not the jobs that nobody else wants to do in the law firm. And I explained to him that the Law Society would not give me the forms. He was just so angry. He walked to the Law Society, brought the forms, asked me to fill them up. I filled them up. The next day he took them. And in 10 days, my qualifications were assessed and I had to do 2 common law exams. And that's the journey. But it just shows that if I hadn't had, for the grace of God, a man that stood by me, a man that, you know, like he said to the Law Society, I'm not taking ifs and buts. Give me the form right now. Why are you not giving it to her? And then when he went, he said, I want this assessed in 10 days because he was a prominent lawyer, a prominent judge. I was able to get the qualifications. Not many people were as lucky as I am.
It's fascinating. Iqbal, we'll swing to you now. Iqbal, you yourself have had a very fascinating career. I mean, there's hardly things. I'm sure if you did a PhD at that time, you wouldn't have been able to do what you did. Iqbal, tell me, how did your life pan out? You mentioned that, yes, you and your cousins had to look after a whole lot of members of the family, and that today, most of them are graduates. And that was your father's philosophy, that we will make sure that those who want to study will study, and that we will not be a drag on the state. But your own personal life, Iqbal, has been very fascinating. I mean, today, you are an authority on Islamic finance. You have worked on the United Nations Sustainable Goals. I know from your work, because we work closely, that you have a deep social purpose when you look at the whole notion of wealth. Tell us, how did the last so many years pan out for you in terms of where you found yourself? What were the bottlenecks you faced? Who were the good angels who came into your life? Tell us a bit about that, please.
So I think that, as I said, I worked diligently for most of the 70s. At the end of the 70s, everybody had studied and so on. And I had a staff mortgage from the Prudential, which we had paid off. So I went to my dad and I said that, look, I have done 1, 2, 3, whatever you asked me. Everybody is okay. Is there anything else you want me to do? He said, no, that's fine. I said, then can I leave my job? And he said, what? What's wrong with you? I said, no, I want to do social things. I don't want to do this business. I've done everything. I mean, nobody's on the road. Everybody's okay. He said, yeah, I told you to do some things and you have done it, so I cannot stop you. My own opinion will be, don't do that. But I went ahead and I joined the Third World Network from Malaysia as an advocate for development studies, development institutions and so on. And then they sent me as their rep to the World Bank NGO Committee, where I did 5 years. And I was chairman of the World Bank NGO Committee, where we had a lot of influence on what kind of development can take place, getting completely rid of the structural adjustment programs, which was penalizing the poor, and trying to do some things which would make life better for lots of people. We also, I mean, much, much earlier than anybody else, we were quite aware of the environmental and climate change position, started to work on that, write on that, advocate for it, and going to all over the world, Europe, Asia, Africa, Vietnam, Mexico, to promote these things, both as the World Bank NGO committee and otherwise. And then one day, you know, I just had a feeling that I need to do something more. So one of my friends invited me to a conference on Islamic finance in Makkah at that time in Saudi Arabia. It was the first one. And I got interested and I said, let's do something. And we started to work for it. And I started, as Mobina says, there are always things which happen which you don't plan. I got a call from a professor at City Business School, Base Business School now. And he said, I need to see you. I said, for what? He said, please come. I went there. And he said, look, I got this. I put my neck out to institute this course on Islamic finance as a module for the masters. But the person who was supposed to do it has backed out. And I am left hanging. And my reputation is at risk. Can you do that course? I said, Prof, I haven't taught anywhere in the university as to now. He said, always a first time, please start. So I prepared myself and we started. And because he was on the line, he said in the first lecture, 120 master's students from all over the world. 3-hour lecture. And I couldn't believe at the end of 3 hours, I got a standing ovation for 5 minutes. I haven't had that in the university since then. And then he said, Iqbal, you are okay. You are natural fit. Just carry on. And that's why I became one of the leading exponents in Islamic finance. The good thing was that after City Business School accepts you, no other university will even ask you for a reference. So have you been working at City? Yeah, okay. Start tomorrow. There's no more. Are you a professor? Have you got a PhD? All those things went out of the way. So we had these lucky breaks. But financially, of course, it was a big sacrifice. Yeah, Prudential was a top situation. And I remember just 6 months ago, my wife was telling me that, look, man, if you had stayed at the Prudential, we wouldn't have to worry about anything today. I said, but we wouldn't know half the world, yeah? Because we would just be a London-based, city-based, elitist fellows. But now with this, we know the globe, we know different people, we know everywhere. And we can almost forget Africa because we know so many other places. You're right, Mobina, that there is a nostalgia, but other good things are happening. Then maybe it is a little bit of a palliative to allow you to recuperate that experience. Thank you,
Mobina. Thank you, Iqbal. Amir, you were a fascinated career as well. Amir, you told me today that you spent a lot of time with the Aga Khan University from around 1985. And I recall I was working at that time with His Highness that the charter was given around that time, 82, 83, 84, important years. Tell us about what drew you to the Aga Khan University and how did you bridge your life at Leicester with your life in Pakistan with a new university, which eventually also had a fallout in East Africa, in Uganda particularly. So could you tell us a bit about those years of yours, Amir, that's so fascinating?
Well, before I speak about my experiences in Pakistan, you know, when I graduated in 1973, knowing that I could not return to Uganda to contribute to teaching and research in my university in Kampala, which had given me an opportunity to acquire postgraduate qualification from a reputed UK university, I had to begin to think about quite earnestly looking for new opportunities to continue my scholarship and achievement in the United Kingdom in order to be able to sustain my family financially culturally, educationally as a scholar. Both my undergraduate and postgraduate qualifications were in the field of human anatomy. I was offered a research associate position at the newly established University of Leicester Medical College in the Department of Anatomy for 2 years, which was a great help financially, although the salaries of the research associate was not very good, but nevertheless, it was better than the funds that I received from the Ugandan government fellowship. It was a godsend opportunity to acquire my first foothold in the long career as an anatomist. Having worked there for 2 years, the university in 1975 appointed me as a lecturer in the Department of Anatomy. And I was involved actively with my professor to set up the anatomy department well before the intake of the medical undergraduates in October that year. I think with this appointment, my career as a professional scholar in the discipline of anatomy began to unfold, which lasted more than 3 decades until 2011. I was one of the longest service academics in the medical college, holding several senior and reputed academic positions. I was very grateful to the University of Leicester because they helped me to get a United Kingdom passport and nationality while I was at Leicester. And then as an appreciation of my contribution to the university as a teacher, as a head of anatomy, and as a director of clinical anatomy, this was my immense contribution to teaching human anatomy in medical education, a discipline which is the cornerstone of learning functional applied in clinical anatomy and its importance and relevance to medical practice. And suddenly, 1983, His Highness the Aga Khan established the medical college in Karachi. Medical college was recruiting basic scientists to undertake education and training for students in Pakistan as medical doctors. I realized it would be appropriate for me to express my interest in joining the medical college. And I remember His Highness the Aga Khan visiting Birmingham in 1983 during his Silver Jubilee visit, implored on professionals to spend some time in the developing world, to give our time and knowledge and expertise to the population in Pakistan. So my desire to pursue this opportunity was served professionally by joining the medical college in the early years of establishment. I was the first person in my community at Leicester to apply for a position. And the motivation to go to Pakistan was to fulfill His Highness's aspirations, which he gave to the guidance to community to contribute time, knowledge, and best practice for some years working at the Aga Khan Institution in developing countries. My involvement with the newly established Aga Khan University in Karachi began in 1984, when I was offered a position of a professor of anatomy at the medical school in Karachi. I was one of the foundation's faculty in the Department of Anatomy, serving as a professor for 1984 and 1985. And then in 2012, I accepted this opportunity to return to the Aga Khan University in Karachi as a professor of anatomy. This academic involvement continued for over 8 years. And as we all know, the Aga Khan University is recently celebrating its 40th anniversary of its inception in Pakistan.
Thank you, Amir. You know, each one of you have contributed so handsomely to rehabilitating yourselves, but also contributing to the greater cause of humanity. Looking back now over the last 50 years, is there anything you think we could have done differently? If we could put the time clock back, what would we as Asians have done in Uganda that could have been right if we could have done it that way? Of course, history cannot be repeated. We can only learn from the past. But is there anything you think that we as an Asian minority ought to have done, could have done, made it possible to happen that might have changed the course of history? Are there any thoughts you have on that? Mobina, can we call on you to say What are your thoughts as you look back? Do you think that we could have done something differently, or did history place us in a very vulnerable position, or was this just a quirk and we had no choice, or we could have done something but we didn't? What are your thoughts, Mobina?
Well, my thoughts may not, you know, may be very different from everybody else in the discourse I hear. There is a lot of Indian bashing that we didn't integrate, we, you know, we left people out, but that was not my experience. My father worked for independence of Uganda. In our home, we had all, you know, all kinds of tribes from Uganda. My father worked in masjids. He built masjids all over Uganda with his African brothers. And so for me, I don't think that my family could have done more, and neither could have my community, because His Highness had built schools, it was integrated. So I don't think that I could look at doing things differently, because I believe we did everything. But you know, if we get punished, we are getting punished for being successful. But we were in Uganda for a long time, when Uganda was very different. And our grandparents and parents really built Uganda. And for that, in many ways, I know this is not the normal view, we got punished, is my belief. But I just truly believe that, as I said to you, that Uganda is in your blood. When you have drunk the water of the Nile, you always go back. I go back many times. My dad has a hotel there. And you know, my mom and dad have both been buried in Uganda. And in fact, President Museveni asked my dad's body to be brought back to Uganda. And he was given all the honors. And earlier on, he was also recognized for his work in independence. And he had a state funeral. So now things in many ways are the same. What could we have done differently? My family, I'm not going to talk about it. My family, maybe we should have been more wise. Maybe we shouldn't have been so, you know, just taking that, oh, this is, I'm in and it'll change and things will change. Because can you imagine, after even my dad was had to flee, my husband and I went back. And one day in Fort Portal, they came to get me. They found out I was my father's daughter, and they came to get me in the home. And my husband stood in the middle and he wouldn't let them take me. Can you imagine what they could have done to me? And they took him. And the 2 days before, they'd taken another Indian, an Ismaili Indian, to the army barracks. And his family is now in Canada, and we've never seen him again. But we were, as I said, I'm a very lucky person. The way they took my husband, I still have nightmares. They had two guns on his head, two guns on his chest. It was just horrible. But my husband and I were lucky that the police arrived. And the police knew my father-in-law very well. And so they took him to the police station. And in the evening, he was released. So when you say, how can you do things differently? Well, how can you be so foolish after your father has fled to go back to Uganda? But I want to end by saying to you, when I went as the envoy of Canada to Uganda, I met with President Museveni. We had some very difficult discussions about what was happening in the Sudan. And after a while, he looked at me and said, I don't know what to do with you, Mobina. We Ugandans threw you out, and you come back to Uganda as the envoy from Canada, and you come back and you are tough with me today when we threw you out. He said, what do Canadians have in their water that they integrate people? And so, you know, so what that tells me is that there is an awareness, even after we are thrown out, there's an awareness. I'm sorry to be bragging, or sorry to be so arrogant, but there's an awareness that if you work hard, you will succeed anywhere. And we Asians work very hard. And we get beaten up. We get beaten up for that. And so I think we should be proud for what we've done in Uganda.
Thank you, Mobina. Iqbal, to you. Iqbal, is there anything that we could have done differently at that time that comes to your mind? You know, there's a lot of stories today that people say, well, you said you were kind to us, but were you really kind to Black people? What was the general feeling? Was there anything we could have done more? Did we integrate enough? I mean, these are the questions that do arise. And of course, Mobina, you gave us one picture of your father being so deeply, integrated with the African struggle. And I do recall Abu Mayanja mentioning that the first time I went to Uganda, he told His Highness that Sher Ali has been one of us. He's been working with us for such a long time. Iqbal, what are your thoughts on this? Can we hear you?
I think this is a difficult one. I don't think we felt that time that, or even now, that we could do something different, as Mobina says. We were doing everything. In fact, we were second, third generation Indians in Uganda. And you could see change slowly coming. We had African friends, we had African schoolmates, we had all kinds of things. I can see that one generation on, we would have been quite close together. So I think it was a question of time. Amin sort of aborted for his own political reasons. As you know, and those of you who know, of course, Uganda well, there was this power struggle between the Uganda and the other tribes north, who wanted a share of power, and the Kabaka and his entourage wanted to keep the Ugandans separate. And we were caught in that sort of play. And Amin came and he thought that, look, if I throw these people out, we will all be rich overnight. It wasn't long before they realized that this is not going to be so. But from our side, I don't know whether we could. I mean, let's be very frank. Coming from an Asian Indian background, it was not possible to integrate in the way you would think of today in a generation. It would have taken 5-6 generations, clearly, to get anywhere else. So, but with that proviso, I think we were doing quite a lot. We were mixing well. We were really, some of us, as Amir has said, we were also trying to help local communities with credit, with all kinds of things which would empower them as well. But there was a disparity in not only wealth, but education. And this was very important. Indians had worked hard. They'd graduated from shopkeepers to a lot of young Indians who were beginning to be educated, got degrees and came back from here and there. So that would need a long time to bridge. I don't think we could have visualized how to do this differently.
Thank you, Iqbal. Amir, your turn now before we come to the end of this program. What do you feel we could have probably done, if at all, to have a different type of an outcome from the one we saw over the last 50 years?
Well, having been out of the country for a long time, okay, and particularly in my professional life, not being there, but what I know of my family, I know of my father, the way he conducted his business and his relationship with the local Africans, knowing how generous he was with them as well, I don't see anything different that he would have done going back to Uganda, because he would have thought that what he had done constructively, you know, for the country, he would continue doing that. As a professional myself, having lived in England for a long time, and then having spent time in Pakistan, in both of them, in Pakistan being in a developing country, that particular experience instilled in me an ethos of behavior and etiquette in trying to impress upon the local people to say that we are with you, we care for you, we will look after you, and we will actually allow you to flower and contribute much more better than what my parents would have done. But my father was an example that he had actually set for us. And I, because of my own experience of the generosity that both England and Pakistan gave me, I would have done exactly the same to see that in my own professional life, I would actually contributed that sort of commitment to the university if I were to return to the university at that time, to see how my experience had given me some, I would say, experience of trying to be fair, to be honest, to be generous, and do something for my own country, because Uganda is still in my heart and in my thoughts. And I would have done something differently from my father in terms of another profession, but my father would have continued to give as much as possible, you know, to the local people, because it was for that sort of behavior that he had, he was actually admired, okay, amongst the local people. And I know that I spent some time with my father in a business in Kampala, and I could see how he treated the people there. And I don't think he would have done anything different. The only difficulty was that because he had to leave Uganda under a very difficult situation, that he had to give up everything, that he still, when he was in England, often thought about how best he could have done things better to make life better for us all when we were to return to Uganda. Thank you.
Thank you, Amir.
Yes. Mohamed, I'm really sorry to interrupt. It's not appropriate, but I just want to leave this one remark. And that is that many times people, you know, put Ugandans together. And I always tell people, it's not Ugandans were like that. It was the dictator. And we must never forget the good people of Uganda and should always make sure we are there for them. Thank you. Sorry I interrupted.
Thank you. Not at all. Thank you for that point.
Mohamed, can I just say something before you go to Fiyaz?
Yes.
You know, I just would like to read a paragraph to you that I really sincerely believe that actually conveys my sentiments. Both on my professional and personal life, I have become resilient and acquired ability to withstand adversity and bounce back from different life events. This has meant undergoing a process of outcome successfully in adapting to different or challenging life experiences, especially through mental, emotional, and behavioral flexibility and adjustment of external and internal demands. In my interaction to others, I have developed my way of directness thinking, which entails frankness, truthfulness, probity, honesty, gentleness, impartiality, and simplicity. And this is my bottom of my heart. I feel that this is something that I have learned from my experiences in England and in Pakistan, hopefully in some other countries in the future, if I'm able to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Amir. Iqbal, just for fairness, would you like to say a few words too?
I think it's been a mixed experience. Yeah, obviously, we had a very comfortable life, and then we had a very uncomfortable period here. We also developed a very hard skin against racism here, I must say. It was ever present, but we faced it, I think. But as we all three of us have experienced, there are always good people around, and you always come across them. So there are people who are really with it, and we just need to find them with patience and perseverance, and you can get anywhere.
Thank you, Iqbal. Fiyaz, I now give the baton to you to say your few words, and then I'll wrap up, and thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Mohamed. I'm going to just make about five or six points that have come out, and I want to mention the term resilience, because it's a term that really has stuck to Ugandan Asians. Resilience doesn't mean that things were easy. Resilience doesn't mean that we were able collectively to cope with everything. What it does mean is that we're still here after 50 years. That's what resilience means. We're still here. We're alive. We've made something of our lives. So I want that just kind of left there in the open, because I think resilience does describe the transition of the Ugandan Asians to places like Canada, United Kingdom, etc. Iqbal mentioned the issue of developing a hard skin. We cannot forget the fact that when Ugandan Asians arrived in this country, it was the height of the Rivers of Blood speech, and it was the height of groups like the National Front. So there was political movement against the relocation of Ugandan Asians. We know that from Leicester and the publicity Leicester put out. And we know that from groups here who didn't want Ugandan Asians settling. So it wasn't all easy. It wasn't about opening the doors and saying, oh, welcome. I mean, there are some narratives that say, oh, we were welcomed and we made a great life. That was not factually accurate. So this is about also understanding that there was resistance to us arriving here in the UK. And I think three other things that I picked up. Senator Jaffer said the surprise, the actual surprise of implementation of the expulsion. The thinking at the time was that actually Amin was not going to pull this through, and that actually he was saying what he was saying, and that he was a real politician in his desire and in his drives. But the shock of his implementation, of his desire to make this happen. And I take away also from what's said today of the responsibilities put, the change of responsibility from parent to children, where parents became children and children became parents to look after their parents. That is a huge transition in a family structure. It is a total imbalance in the power structure of a family. Parents become the children and have their sense of decision-making taken away from them, and children having to step up and become the parents and take decisions which were never theirs to take at the ages, young ages, 18, 19, 20, 21. And so that transition of a generational shift and flip of responsibility needs to be mentioned, and it's heard through the stories today. And I finish off by saying, lastly, the fact that actually in this process, people had to adapt, change, feel the loss, feel the hope, have a good day, have a bad day, and just try to survive is what comes through quite considerably. And so there's a richness about this discussion and a richness about the human spirit in this discussion, which I think also shows and shines a light on the nature of the Ugandan Asian population to survive in any climate, whether that be in Africa, United Kingdom, or in Canada. Thanks, Mohamed.
Thank you, Fiyaz. Fiyaz, thank you for those very deep observations, which I thought were very thoughtful. And you're talking about how roles change, the whole notion of resilience, the question of our braving racism. I find this whole topic absolutely fascinating. Uganda to me is a metaphor for the vulnerability of hardworking people who get punished for their enterprise. And I've just come back from Malaysia 4 or 5 days ago. I spoke in South Africa 6 months ago. And when I look at the entire settler colonies where Asians were brought in, either for the plantation, sugar, palm oil, rubber, railways, railway clerks, railway workers. That's the history of the Asian diaspora from Mahatma Gandhi right up to the present day. And I'm fascinated by this discussion only for the reason that every time I talk to somebody from Malawi or Botswana or South Africa or Malaysia or Trinidad or Tobago or Guyana or Suriname or Uganda or Tanzania or Kenya or Zanzibar or Madagascar or Mauritius, is the same question, is that are the Asians going to be seen only as money-making instruments, or are they seen as part of the community? From what we've spoken about today, we've seen that there was integration, there was sincerity, There was all the accoutrement to become part of the country, but we were probably placed in a very invidious position. And the question I asked today, is this only a blip? Is Uganda just a quirk? Or could Uganda happen tomorrow in South Africa? Could Uganda happen again in Guyana, for example? Can Uganda happen in Madagascar? And I tell Asian communities in all those countries, do not be seen only as people with wealth, but we do exactly what you have said today, that let us integrate, let us make the world a better place for all those who live there. Not that we could have done more, we tried, but remember, in a world of a convergence of the question of ethno-religiosity, race, color, class, and authoritarianism, a minority community that is hardworking, resilient, and apparently successful can always get easily scapegoated. And I think it's important for us to know our history, to be able to be proud of who we are, of the contribution we've made, of the difficulties we faced even in the countries we came to, without kowtowing. I'm always saying we have to be grateful to all the people who have opened their doors to us, but let us not be myopic that we were not totally accepted with red carpet. We had to work hard. But to all the countries that we've come to, it's a great tribute that they've allowed us to flourish, that our children today are being able to feel much more stronger than we are, hopefully contributing to a pluralistic world in which meritocracy will shine and where people will be able to live together. With those words, I'd like to say thank you to our wonderful, distinguished panel of people. You make us proud. You've given us a narrative that we've not early easily listened to. I want to thank Fiyaz for his vision of looking at the deeper things that migration gives rise to, and to all the people who have made this such a wonderful session, particularly to Max for being so diligent and working with me late hours of the night when I send him a telex or a sort of a email from some godforsaken country in the world where I am, and he's within 24 hours responded positively. I want to thank everybody. And Mobina, I'd like to thank your colleague, Gavin, your assistant, for being so good in making this possible. And Iqbal, Fiyaz, Amin, and everybody, thank you for a wonderful, wonderful session. We hope this will contribute to the education of children in the United Kingdom, in Canada, and in other parts of the world, to see how a successful immigration process can take place through the values that we cherish to make a better world for everybody. Thank you very much, all of you.
Thank you for watching this panel discussion. To find out more about the project From East to West, the History of Ugandan Asians, and the other work we are doing, please head to our website, www.ugandanasians.com.